Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala sayyidil mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsan ila yaumiddin. Amma ba'du faqad qala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fil Qur'an al-Majid. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu isbiru was-sabiru warabitu wattaqullaha la'allakum tuflihun. My dear respected brothers and sisters, we begin by saying Alhamdulillah. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator and our sustainer, the one who has given us life in this world and the one who has given us guidance. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this month of Ramadan that He has given to us, a month wherein we could seek His forgiveness, a month wherein we could earn His pleasure, a month wherein we can increase and raise our status towards the Jannah. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this month. This was a month of many challenges. There were internal challenges in our country. There were external problems such as what is going on in Syria and Burma and so on. Yet through it all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the opportunity to fast in Ramadan, to pray, to recite Quran. And the month of Ramadan, its objective is taqwa. And one of the ways of obtaining that taqwa, it is through patience. It is a month of patience. Huwa shahrus sabr. Just as today in these conditions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking you to exercise some patience. The entire month of Ramadan was a month in which, inshallah, you would have gained patience. But patience is not enough in today's times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us in the Holy Quran to have more than just patience. When He says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, be patient. Be patient. Isbiru. And then He says, Wasabiru, and be even more patient. Be patient, and then He says, be more patient. Warabitu. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, guard your frontiers. Wattaqullah. And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah tells us, what is the criteria for this taqwa? To have patience. To have more patience. To guard the frontiers of Islam. Ribat, that is spoken about here, means that when a Muslim community is living on some land, they have the responsibility to protect that land from enemy. And to protect that land, to guard the frontiers of the Muslim land, is a great service for Islam. A great service for Islam. In fact, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith, "Ribatu yawmin fi sabilillah." A person who does ribat and he guards the frontiers of the land, in other words, he stands guard so that no enemy can attack the Muslims while they are doing their normal activities. He dedicates his day or his night or his life towards this. One day like this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma 'alayha." It is better than what is in the world. It is better than the world and what is in it. Today we don't have ribat. We don't have to guard our frontiers physically. But we as Muslims have to guard Islam itself. We have got to protect Islam against misinterpretation, against false beliefs, against false opinions. We as Muslims have got to stand up and show what is the true Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that when we stand for Islam, when we protect the frontiers of Islam, there is no greater reward. This world is not enough of a reward. That it is better than this world and all that is contained in it. So another meaning of ribat is a person who he is so eager to please his creator that he makes his wudu, his ablution, and he goes to the masjid and he performs his salah in congregation and he is waiting for the other salah. This is ribat. He is waiting for the next salah, waiting for the next salah. He wants to please his Lord. He wants to show gratitude to his Lord. This is ribat. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to patience to more patience, and then to having that quality of zeal for Islam. And all of these can be packaged into one word. One word, and that word is resilience. Resilience. What is resilience? Resilience is the ability to recover readily from any adversity. Because when we need patience against adversity. When we need more patience, we need more patience against more adversity. And when we need to protect Islam, we need to protect Islam against adversity. This year, alhamdulillah, our nation is celebrating 50 years as an independent nation. And when you look back at the history of this nation, you will see that there were many occasions where there was a need for resilience of our people. Whether it was a natural disaster, whether it was some turmoil, some uprising, some riot, something of the sort, it required resilience from our people to reach where we are today, 50 years of independence. Look at this masjid that we are in today. Today this masjid has, this year this masjid celebrates 50 years since it has been rebuilt and 100 years since the first building of this masjid. For this masjid to be in this condition, with so many people attending this masjid, it has required resilience of the people who built this masjid and who maintain this masjid year after year after year. Resilience is a quality that we need as Muslims. And we see the most resilience coming from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet Muhammad, our Prophet, had to undergo so much of torment, so much of torture, so much of adversity, so much of difficulty in establishing Islam. He was called a madman. He was called a heretic. He was called a poet. He was beaten. Filth was thrown on him. He had to undergo the adversity and the loss of his wife, Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and his companions, and to move from his beloved Makkah to Medina, and so much of adversity he had to undergo. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him that because of his resilience, because he was resilient, and because he would bounce back after every adversity, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the fadilat and the favor and the gift of the Mi'raj to leave Makkah and go to Jerusalem, and then to go up into the heavens, passing all of the different heavens, passing the different prophets, and going into or close to the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No other human being or angel had gone so close. It came because of resilience. And my dear brothers and sisters, as we go forward, as a nation, we need resilience. And as Muslims, we need to have that quality of resilience as well. But in what areas is resilience needed? Where do we need to be resilient as Muslims? The first way, the first area, is in the practice of the true Islam. Unfortunately, today, there are many isms and schisms about Islam. There are many different varieties and different sects and different understandings about Islam. But as Muslims, we must be resilient and we must practice the true Islam that was brought to us by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We must follow the Holy Quran and we must follow the Sunnah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the Messenger of Allah. وَمَا آتَاكُمْ رَسُولٌ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Messenger gives to you, take it. And whatever he forbids you, then abstain from it. In a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, narrated by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says, if anyone, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if anyone introduces into our matter something which does not belong to it, he will have it rejected. He will have it rejected. If anybody tries to change the Islam that we follow, if anyone tries to deviate from what is Quran and Sunnah, If anyone tries to invent a new Islam, he will have that rejected. What does it mean to have it rejected? It means that he will be punished in the fire of Jahannam. It means that he will be a loser on the day of judgment. So my dear brothers and my dear sisters, we must practice that Islam which was brought by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Kullu bid'atun dhalalah." That every innovation is a misguidance. وَكُلُّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. And every misguidance is in the fire of hell. Every misguidance is in the fire of hell. We must be resilient as Muslims and ensure that the Islam that we practice is the true Islam. But for that to happen, we must learn Islam. How many of us know the truth? How many of us seek the truth? How many of us want to know what is the truth? How many of us want to know what is right and what is wrong? We must be resilient against any form of misguidance and practice that Islam that will make us resilient, that will give us resilience like we saw in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the second way in which we need resilience, it is with regard to the affairs of this world. We need to start thinking more and more about our hereafter. Sometimes we get caught up too much in this life and we forget that this is a temporary life. And the real life is the life of the hereafter. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us? He tells us in Surah Hashr, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and let every soul look to what it has sent for tomorrow. Meaning, look at the good deeds you have sent. Look at the bad deeds you are sending as well. Try to balance them off. We do not think about what we are sending for tomorrow. We do not think about our words and the consequences of our words. We do not think about our actions and the consequences of our actions. And therefore, we cannot be resilient as Muslims. We cannot bounce back readily from adversity. Any adversity that afflicts us, we fall down, we give up, we leave Islam. We stop practicing Islam, we don't come to the masjid. We have no resilience. We fall down. We must get up, pick ourselves up, dust off our laurels, and keep moving as Muslims. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Once in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, early in the morning, he was sitting with his companions. A group of people came. They were barefooted. They were scantily clothed. And he recognized that they were very, very poor people from the tribe of Mudar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's countenance and his face changed. He told Bilal to call the Adhan. The Adhan was called, the Iqama was called, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the prayer. And then after he led the prayer, he recited a verse of the Holy Quran from chapter 4, verse 1. Ya ayyuha an-nas ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida. O mankind, fear Allah who created you from a single soul. And then he recited the verse, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullah wal tanzur nafsum ma qaddamat lighad. O believers, fear Allah. And let everyone look to what they are sending for tomorrow. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited these verses of Quran. And the people understood what it meant. It meant that these people, the tribe of Mudar, who are not even Muslims, they have come to you in a state of poverty and in a state of adversity and in a state of need. What is your response? What are you sending for tomorrow? Immediately the dirhams started coming in, the dinars, the silver coins, the gold coins, the wheat, the barley, the dates, till a person would bring whatever he could afford, half of a date he would bring, half of a date. And then the countenance of the face of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam changed, because it meant that the people understood that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking to see what you are doing for tomorrow. And He asked them to give charity, give to those who are in need. This is focusing on the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next part of this verse, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. And do not be like those who forgot Allah. Do not be like those who forgot Allah, who forget to remember Allah, who forget to thank Allah, who forget to worship Allah, who forget to seek forgiveness from Allah. So Allah made them forget themselves. Allah made them forget about doing good deeds. Allah made them turn only towards the affair of this world, never considering and thinking about the hereafter. When we forget Allah, Allah will make us forget ourselves. We have to remember Allah and turn to Him and ask Allah for patience, more patience, to be able to guard the frontiers of Allah. Ask Allah for resilience. Allah says, لا يستوي الأصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون. Allah says, not equal are the people of the fire and the people of the paradise. The people of the paradise, they are the ones who are the successful ones. And after that incident of the people of Madr, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a hadith in which it is reported that he said, whosoever sets a good example in Islam, whosoever sets a good example in Islam, like these people set a good example of bringing in charity for those who are in need, that there is a reward for him and a reward for that, for those people who acted according to it subsequently, without any deduction in their good deeds, in their rewards. So a person does a good deed and other people follow him. Those people who follow him, they will get the reward of the good deed as well. But the person who initiated that good deed, he will get their reward as well, without their reward being ever decreased. And he said as well, whosoever sets in Islam an evil example, there is for him the burden of that evil, and the burden of him also who acted upon it subsequently without any deduction from their burden. And therefore we have to ask ourselves, what kind of examples are we setting as Muslims? Are we setting examples which are good examples, or are we setting evil examples and others are following us and we have to bear in the burden of their sin because we started that example, we started that wrong deed? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, not equal are the people of the fire and the people of the paradise. The people of the paradise, they are the successful ones. And my dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to focus on a Jannah, on a paradise that He has created for us. A paradise that we cannot even imagine. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, Allah, that I have prepared for my righteous. I have prepared for my righteous slaves, my righteous slaves, what no eye has seen. Today we see the Maserati, we see the Porsche, we see the Land Rover. This is what we want. But in the Jannah, we will get such gifts that no eye has ever seen them. No eye has ever seen those beautiful gifts and rewards in this world. Nothing compares to them. Even when the hadith talks about the fruits of Jannah, the fruits of Jannah are not like the fruits of this world. The fruits of Jannah are different in taste and color and scent. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah says, I have prepared for my righteous servants what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard. The beautiful sounds, think about the most beautiful sound that you ever heard in this world. Whether it is the sound of the stream rushing by as it hits the rocks, whether it is the sound of the birds chirping in the morning. But the sound that we will hear in the Jannah, no ear has ever heard those sounds. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, and the mind of no man has conceived. We cannot even think about what Allah has prepared for us if it is that we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it is that we become resilient in this deen. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you wish, recite a verse of the Quran, chapter 32, verse 17. No person knows what is kept hidden for them of joy. No person knows what is kept hidden for them of joy and happiness as a reward for what they used to do. As a reward for what they used to do. So my dear brothers and my dear sisters, if we become resilient in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward us with paradise. And one other quality we must have, if we want to be resilient, if we want to have patience, if we want to be able to bounce back after every adversity and not let the adversity bring us down, because there are always going to be tests, there are always going to be problems. Which prophet do we know? Can we name a prophet who never underwent adversity? Can we name a messenger who didn't undergo hardship? Can we name a sahaba, a sahabi, a companion of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who didn't undergo some difficulty and hardship? Can we name an imam like the imams of fiqh, like the magazine we are doing this year about Imam Abu Hanifa, but Imam Ahmad, Imam Shafi? Can we name an imam of fiqh who didn't undergo adversity, who didn't undergo hardship? Hardship and adversity and difficulty will come, but we have to be resilient. And how do we be resilient? We turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Holy Quran, إِن يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. If Allah helps you, if Allah helps you, there is none to overcome you. If Allah helps you, you will get resilience. If Allah helps you, you will be resilient. If Allah helps you, you will have patience. If Allah helps you, you will practice this true Islam. If Allah helps you, you will focus on the hereafter and send your rewards for the hereafter. If Allah helps you, none to overcome you. وَإِن يَقْذُلْكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِي. And if He abandons you, if Allah abandons us, then who is there who can help you after that? If we do not have the help of Allah, we can never be successful in this world. So we need the help of Allah, and Allah will help us. And then Allah says, وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And in Allah, the believers should place their trust. Do we really trust Allah? Do we really have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we really put our faith in Allah? If we put our faith in Allah, then we will be resilient. If we really turn to Allah, then who can overcome us? We have to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have faith in Allah, and Allah will help us. And if Allah abandons us, who can help us? Let us put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But my dear brothers and my dear sisters, when we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help, we must also be such people who are helping Allah. We must also be such people who are ready to put out and sacrifice and stand up for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ وَهُوَ سَيِّدُ الصَّادِقِينَ. The leader of the truthful, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there will constantly be a group from my ummah. There will constantly be a group from my ummah steadfast upon the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Steadfast upon the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَائِمَةٌ بِأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. From the very beginning of time, from the Sahaba, through the generations, till today, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the leader of the truthful, has said that there will constantly be a group from my ummah who will be steadfast upon the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will not be harmed in any way by those who abandon their help. They will not be harmed in any way by those who refuse to help Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who forget Allah, so Allah forgets them. They will not be harmed by them, nor by those who oppose them. People who want to say that Islam is this or Islam is that, those who want to place false allegations against Islam, those who want to add verses of the Quran and change the Quran, those who want to portray Islam in the negative sense, in the wrong way, they will never overcome that group of people who will constantly be in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, they will remain, this will remain their condition until the final hour ordained by Allah has arrived. In other words, there is always going to be people who stand up for the deen of Allah. My brothers, my sisters, are we those people? Are we such people? Do we find ourselves in this group? Just like our nation requires that we stand up for nationhood. Just like as we reach 50 years of independence, for the next 50 years, we have to stop looking backward and start looking forward so that we can join together as a nation and make this place a place that we can all feel free and happy to worship and to live. In a similar way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls upon us to stand up for His deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call us to be those people who are resilient. Are we those people who reject innovations? Are we those people who promote unity and harmony? Are we those people who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly, ribat, with zeal, waiting for the next time to worship our Creator? Are we those people who are the shining examples of what a Muslim stands for? Are we those people who are shining examples of Islam? Are we those people who stand up for justice? Are we those people who are patient? Are we those people who are honest? Are we those people who are dedicated? Are we those people who generation after generation, we practice our Islam according to the Quran and the Sunnah? And we are in the group of the people who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says are steadfast upon the commands of Allah. My brothers and sisters, are we those people who are resilient? Are we the resilient ones? Are we that group? We have to belong to that group. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven us, inshaAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has elevated our status, and now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls us to stand up, be resilient, and be ambassadors of this deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His mercy, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His power, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His ilm and wisdom and knowledge make us the group of people who will be the resilient ones for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this deen of Islam, for this nation, to give the right moral, correct etiquettes and morals to our people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our efforts in the month of Ramadan and accept our efforts now and for the rest of our lives. Make us resilient for deen. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.
Ramadan has come and gone, Eid has dawned upon us. Thank you Allah for this blessing day. It's a time of happiness, a time of joy. Thank you Allah for this blessing day. عيد سعيد يوم فرحان يوم جميل عيد سعيد عيد سعيد يوم جميل يوم فرحان عيد سعيد. All over the world, under the big blue sky, Muslims unite to worship Allah. It's a time of brotherhood, a time